And I truly believe Doink the Clown is one of the most underappreciated, underrated characters in the history of WWE. I think the version of Doink the Clown that we got in 1993 and 1993 only is literally a top 10 character of all time. Allow me to explain. 1993 is not thought of as the greatest time in the world for WWE or for pro wrestling in general. 1993 was a big time switch up. Okay, it was a transitional period. Hulk Hogan was gone. The Ultimate Warrior was gone. Macho Man Randy Savage was for the most part in the commentary booth. And we were left without the big stars that had taken us through the last 10 plus years. The WWE hadn't quite, in my opinion, pulled the trigger on guys like Bret Hart and Shawn Michaels. They were experimenting. They put the title on Bret Hart, but I don't think they ever elevated, or at least at that point, Bret Hart to the place where guys like Hulk Hogan and the Ultimate Warrior were. Instead, what they were doing was showcasing people like Bret, but also trying to introduce a ton of new characters, throwing as much as they could at the wall to see what stuck. And one of the things that the WWE threw at the wall was to introduce a wrestling clown. Now, on paper, Doink the Wrestling Clown has no reason to succeed. You wouldn't expect it to succeed. And I think most people remember Doink as kind of a goof, as kind of a silly character. They remember Doink coming to the ring with Dink. Maybe you remember the Survivor Series. We had a Dink and Wink and Pink, and he had Jerry Lawler and Sleazy and Wheezy and Cheesy. But this isn't the Doink that I'm talking about. The Doink that I'm talking about is rookie year Doink. The Doink that I'm talking about is 1993 Doink the Clown, a completely different Doink than the one that I think fills all our brains when we think about this character. So Doink shows up at the end of 1992 in WWE audiences on WWE TV shows. Already, not the greatest sign of success. I mean, you've had a couple of people. You've had Santino. He showed up in a crowd for the first time and won the Intercontinental Championship. But he was in the crowd one night. Doink the Clown was in the crowd show after show after show. That's usually reserved for characters like Abe Knuckleball Schwartz and Jameson, not the who's who of WWE Hall of Famers. But point is, the Doink would be in the audience and he'd be playing pranks on some of the audience members. And you almost thought it could be a mascot. Is this the second coming of the gobbledygooker? Then Doink the Clown showed up at ringside, and he would show up in the aisleway, and he would start playing pranks that were fairly mean-spirited on good guy wrestlers of the day. And you'd start to get this hint, maybe this isn't a friendly clown. Maybe this isn't a mascot after all. Maybe this is an evil clown. And that's where things start to get interesting, because Doink the Clown, regardless of if everybody else was saying, this is going to be a joke, this is not going to work, this is going to be so dumb, Doink the Clown made you believe that he had evil in his soul. You did not see a man portraying a character that he didn't believe in when you looked at Doink the Clown. When you looked at Doink the Clown, you saw an evil clown that would go in the ring and tear you limb from limb and then laugh about it after the match. You believed in Doink the Clown, whether you would even admit it or not. Because who wants to believe in a wrestling clown? But you believed in Doink the Clown, because Doink the Clown in 1993 made you believe in Doink the Clown.